As the COVID-19 outbreak spread in the beginning of 2020, every nation was bracing for its arrival on their soil. But what happens when a case is detected in a country for the first time? Well, you're about to meet the scientist who was the first person on the scene when COVID arrived in South Africa.
It was a normal day at the office, you know. I came to work, started checking my emails, had tea, you know, had a few meetings. Then it was around, I think, 10 o'clock or so when my phone rang. I got a call from Dr. Natalie Mayette, who is the deputy director of the NICD. She doesn't call me very often, but I wasn't expecting that it was the news she was about to announce. And she told me, "Villian, we got our first case. Pack your bag. You have to go to KwaZulu-Natal province."
Dr. Villyen Motaze is the exact person you'd want on the job of containing a deadly outbreak. He's a medical doctor who practiced for 4 years in his home country of Cameroon before earning his master's degree in epidemiology in South Africa, where he's currently completing his PhD. He's responded to two Ebola outbreaks in the Democratic Republic of Congo in 2018 and 2019, and now he's the head of the Notifiable Medical Conditions Program at the National Institute for Communicable Diseases in South Africa.
So the first COVID case in South Africa was a gentleman who returned to South Africa from a holiday trip in Europe. A few days after they returned, he was feeling unwell. So he went to see his doctor, and given the signs and symptoms that he presented, the doctor thought that this could be COVID. And when the sample was tested at NICD, it was confirmed as being positive for COVID.
Villian knew that containing this case would require top epidemiological talent and assembled an incredible team to get to work.
First, there was the field team deployed from the NICD, which consisted of myself and my colleagues. We were tasked with tracing and collecting samples from contacts of the first case and instructing them on isolation protocols. We collaborated with the local response team that had been established by the KwaZulu-Natal Provincial Department of Health. We also coordinated with the team based at the NICD campus in Johannesburg, where the national response team was organized and sample testing was being conducted. Finally, there was a national incident management team, which included representatives from various government departments and international partners like the World Health Organization.
There was a lot of stakeholders that came together in order to work to make sure that all these activities were a success. The overall objective of my deployment on the ground was simply to stop the spread of this infection from this one individual who had been diagnosed from spreading to other people in the community. Since the first case that was diagnosed was already identified and this person was already isolated in the hospital, or me and the team, we had to actually go to each and every one of the contacts of that first case. It was contacts who traveled with this gentleman. It was individuals seated on the plane with him. And it also involved his family members who had met him when he returned from this trip.
I asked Villian to take us through one of these contact visits to collect samples.
Collecting samples from an infected individual is actually a risky procedure. And if not done properly, the person collecting the sample or the individuals around might get infected. We had to make sure that we had the appropriate personal protective equipment or PPE in order to gain the person's trust. We had spoken to these people prior to going to their houses, and when we arrived, we called on the phone to say, okay, we are outside, this is the car we're driving. And in order not to attract a lot of attention from neighbors, you know, who might now start stigmatizing this individual, we entered the property in reverse, and then we went out with our normal clothes. We opened the booth, and then we changed into our PPE outside, you know, outside the house behind the car. That enabled us to now walk into the person's house without being seen by the entire block. We didn't want to raise any alarm. So when we got into the houses, we had to guide the patient or the individual to sit in a specific position. Then we collected the samples, and then we had to sanitize every place we had touched, you know, every surface we had touched before we left. We had to explain to every single family we visited how they had to carry out isolation procedures. So we had to explain to them how to separate themselves from their family members, how to use their own utensils, how to sleep in their own bedroom, use their own bathroom, basically separate from their family. And that is never an easy thing for someone to do. And when leaving, it was the same procedure we had to follow. We had to, you know, remove all our personal protective equipment at the boot of the car and put it in a biohazard bag and close it, you know, and sanitize it and put it in a specific corner of the boot before we drove off. So it was really a tricky procedure. It was a bit difficult, you know, because somebody's entering your house wearing all this gear and you can't really see the person's face. Bearing in mind that some of the time we had to do this at, I don't know, 11 p.m., even midnight, you know, some people were kind enough and collaborative enough to open their doors to us at that late hour of the night.
If you think that's intense, Villian and his team had to come up with equally stringent protocols for packing, cooling, and shipping all of the samples they collected back to the NICD for testing. The contacts lived in the cities of Pietermaritzburg and Durban, which are an hour apart, so the team had to travel back and forth and back and forth as each contact returned their calls. And the most amazing part?
In order to visit all the other contacts and collect all the samples and batch and send, it was about 25 individuals we had to meet and collect samples from. And we did all of that in about 3 days.
As I was listening to Villian describe these experiences, there was, of course, one big question on my mind. What was the outcome?
I can say we contained the first case. There were a couple of positive individuals among the contacts of the first case, and there were a number of symptomatic contacts who eventually tested positive for COVID. And they were isolated, you know, following the national guidelines in South Africa, and they were treated. You know, there was not widespread transmission of COVID from this group of people. That suggests to us that they complied with the advice we gave them with respect to self-isolation at home and the measures they had to take to distance themselves from their relatives and friends and family. We did not have any positive COVID case among the field team that was on the ground. So I think that was a success on our part. We succeeded to respect the infection prevention and control guidelines when we were wearing our PPE and when we were interacting with the patients or the individuals.
South Africa did ultimately experience a severe COVID outbreak, and Villian explains how this can happen even after such a successful first case containment.
Well, eventually, a number of other cases were detected in different parts of the country, and many of these cases were not linked in any way to this initial cluster of cases that I went to work on in the field. That strongly suggests that, you know, there were multiple importations into the country by different individuals. It might have happened that many cases were asymptomatic or had only mild symptoms. They were not identified and isolated rapidly enough to stop spread. I think that these best practices from this experience could also help in responding to future outbreaks or to future importation of cases. If these lessons are shared and there's a lot more training of personnel that is going to be deployed in case there's an outbreak which is detected, that will really be helpful, you know, in controlling future outbreaks in South Africa. One of the biggest threats, I would say, to successfully containing an outbreak is the way information flows, you know, to and from the public. There's a lot of misinformation out there. Sometimes it is deliberate and sometimes it is not. But the COVID pandemic has definitely showed us that, you know, social media especially is very powerful. The population has to trust what you're doing. You know, if the people I was going to see didn't trust me and I didn't communicate openly with them, they wouldn't have opened their doors to me at midnight, you know. So that is just a few individuals I dealt with. But from a population point of view, the way healthcare workers interact with the communities has to really be improved such that people understand what we're doing, people trust what we're doing, and that leaves less room for misinformation. It has to happen also when there is no outbreak, because there's the preparedness aspect. You don't only respond to outbreaks, you need to prepare because these things happen. This is not the first pandemic, and this definitely will not be the last pandemic.
Villian, thank you so much for sharing your story with us and for all of your work at the front lines of this pandemic. We really appreciate it and the work that you're doing. And thank you to the Vlog Brothers and Team Halo for supporting this work. And don't forget to subscribe to hear more stories from COVID researchers. Bye.
Thanks very much, Molly. Bye.